have an image of the woman I hope to become. I am not her yet. But I am trying. I am trying.
When we are little girls, our families, teachers, and peers insist that our loud voices, bold opinions, and strong feelings are too much and unladylike, so we learn not to trust our personalities. Childhood stories promise us that girls who dare to leave the path or explore get attacked by big bad wolves and pricked by deadly spindles, so we learn not to trust our curiosity.
The beauty industry convinces us that our thighs, frizz, skin, fingernails, lips, eyelashes, leg hair, and wrinkles are repulsive and must be covered or manipulated, so we learn to not trust the bodies we live in.
Diet culture promises us that controlling our appetite is the key to our worthiness, so we learn to not trust our own hunger. Politicians insist that our judgment about our bodies and futures cannot be trusted, so our own reproductive systems must be controlled by lawmakers we don't know in places we've never been.
The legal system proves to us time and time again that even our own memories and experiences will not be trusted. If 20 women come forward and say, "He did it," and he says, "No, I didn't," they will believe him while discounting and maligning us every damn time.
And religion, sweet Jesus. The lesson of Adam and Eve, the first formative story I was told about God in a woman, is this. When a woman wants more, she defies God, betrays her partner, curses her family, and destroys the world.
We weren't born distrusting and fearing ourselves. That was a part of our taming. We were taught to believe that who we are in our natural state is bad and dangerous. They convinced us to be afraid of ourselves, so we do not honor our bodies, curiosities, hunger, judgment, experience, or ambition. Instead, we lock away our true selves. Women who are best at this disappearing act win the highest praise.
She is so selfless.
Can you imagine? The epitome of womanhood is to lose oneself completely.
That's the end goal of every patriarchal culture. Because a very effective way to control women is to convince women to control themselves.
Let it begin. Let Adam in. Step one, original sin. Underneath the leaves, Adam found Eve. Both of them found something sweet under the apple tree. Then it was over. Step two, learning how to lie. Let me ask a question to present day. How the hell did Eve end up with all the damn blame? All the damn blame. Two, all the dirty looks, the kitty cat calls, to the ones who try and throw us up against the back walls. Let me tell you something you'll understand.
Only the little boys tell you they're a big man.
To all my sisters and all our friends, we have to thank them, please. Strength means blessed with an enemy. All of my armor comes from you. You make me try harder.
Stronger.
poetry brought science, sowed quiet seeds of self-reliance, bloomed in me. So here I am. You think I am high and mighty, mister?
Wait till you meet my little sister.
Oh, my, 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 my armor comes from you. You make me try, 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 try harder. Oh,
that's all I ever do.
Ever do. Oh, no, no, my, 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 my armor comes from you. You make me stronger, stronger.
Hand me my armor.
Hand me my armor. You make me strong.
What defines a woman? Our initiation into womanhood is pepper spray and a talk from our mothers on how to fear men. Never walk home alone at night. Always park under a street lamp. Never leave your drink unattended. I've heard this narrative so many times that I've adopted it as my own. I carry the trauma of generations of women in that pepper spray, though I've never had to use it. Damned if I carry it in my pocket, because why do I think I'll ever need it? But damned if I don't, because what if that's the one time that it happens? I mean, sure, I've been catcalled on the street and eyed on buses and harassed at work. I mean, what woman hasn't? It doesn't really count. I didn't have to use it. But is that what womanhood is? Because even as I'm discussing what it means to be a woman, I'm really discussing us in the context of men. Men who love us, men who use us, men who grab our asses at parties and yell names from across the street. Our initiation into womanhood is preparing to be hurt by men. But I know that's not what being a woman is. It's so many beautiful things. I just can't think of them right now.
Things and moments that make me love being a woman.
Dancing in my underwear.
When I drive alone, belting out songs to an empty highway.
Female friendships that just work.
I love my mind, the softness and strength of my voice as I speak in poetry. Maya Angelou, Sylvia Plath, Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie prod at my back, holding me, then pushing me forward.
The surprise on a man's face when he registers that I've said something brilliant.
Telling equally drunk girls in sticky bathrooms that no one deserves them.
When I read books by kick-ass female authors.
This is hard.
I like social dancing. I'm held and spun, orbiting around the presence of others. Responsibilities are lifted, and I can see this being used against me, but sometimes I just like to respond and give back naturally. I'm not alone.
When I see the curvature of my body as I lay in bed.
When another girl tells me I'm pretty.
Playing with my boobs?
When my mom had bunko nights.
When I look back at old photos of my grandmother and realize that my wide hips are built just like hers.
When I get free things, sometimes.
When I watch Dirty Dancing.
When children want me to hold them.
When I bond with my waitress.
A sexy shower cry.
Yes, girl moments.
I sat on the toilet last night, and a thought was circling around in my head. I wish she would have said I was beautiful. She didn't say I was beautiful. And loving and being loved are not the same thing. I remember those words in Laura Dern's caring tone. But I think it might have been confirmation, permission to know that I looked nice, because I thought I did. And so later, when I looked at the pictures, and my admiration surfaced with so much hesitancy, I didn't want to believe it. I saw the tensing in my throat, the chubby fat by my armpit straighten, and the bone in my sternum between my tiny childlike breasts that lay flat against my ribs, exposed and scary. I thought about my father's judgment and the day he called me a whore when I left for school wearing red eyeshadow. He said it with such lightness and nonchalance that I stopped in my tracks, frowned, and knew exactly that this is what it is to live in a female body, and know that terms and conditions will always apply, no matter how much you wish they wouldn't. It is baked into our bones. And I just want to feel pretty.
I like the blue dress. She took my hand so sweetly and said, patiently,
baby, he will come, you just wait and see.
And she told me,
don't be easy,
you just wait and see,
baby, he will come, you just wait and see.
Why are you so sad? She stitched my lips so pretty and laughed. What's with all these silly questions? I believe in all my lessons. Then I wiped a tear from her face, and she hid my hand away. She said one more thing before you go. There's something you need to know. See that girl in the distance. Look at her, that's a paperback princess.
don't help her. We hear she slays her own dragons. Look at her scars and look at her wounds. I guess there's some things that a pretty dress won't consume. Cinderella said, gotta use your head. Wait patiently, baby, he will come, you just wait and see. And she told me, don't be easy. You just wait and see, baby, he will come, you just wait and see. Cinderella said.
Are you guys excited?
I'm so excited. Wait.
Okay. Hi.
Oh my God. Okay.
Body confidence? Will you accept this rose?
No. It was amazing.
Healthy communication? Will you accept this rose?
Absolutely amazing. It's so good. I'm so happy for you.
Oh my God.
Feeling worthy? Bold texts and accepting compliments. Will you accept this rose? Going to therapy, declining to go out with weird boys, and eating whatever the hell I want. You're invited to. Being present. Will you accept this rose?
Oh my God, amazing.
Getting the COVID vaccine? Come get this rose, baby.
Yes!
You get it.
Cool.
Yes! Oh my God.
Thanks for watching me. Oh my God. Did I do
so good?
Body confidence? Will you accept this rose? Healthy communication? Will you accept this rose? Feeling worthy? Bold texts? And accepting compliments? Will you accept this rose? Going to therapy, declining to go out with weird boys, and eating whatever the hell I want? You're invited to. Being present? Will you accept this rose?
I love me. I love me not. 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 I love me. Love me not. I love me. I love me not. I love me.
I can't pinpoint the exact moment when I realized the weight of being a woman. I don't think it was just one moment. I think it was fragments, pieces that I had to put together. When I realized that boys could put their hands wherever they wanted without facing repercussions, that they could use my body as a playground for their own enjoyment. When I realized that no matter what I wore, said, wanted, or did, I would be judged for it. When even my own relationships with other women were cracked because a man could squeeze his way into a place not meant for him and break it My body feels like a canvas that other people have had the privilege of painting on, covering it with what they want, and not even letting it dry before the next coat of paint is drenched on me. These are pieces of who I am now. And as much as I try to let go of things that have let go of me, these moments cling to me. They dig their claws in and they scratch away at the image of strength that I try to put on. They cover me, like I'm being buried alive by the words and actions of others. And each time I try to climb out, I'm met with more dirt piled on top of me. I'm suffocating. But the exact moment you give up is when it stops hurting. So I know I haven't given up because it still hurts. So I climb out of the grave dug for me by a society that wants to see me 6 feet under. I climb out and I pick up the pieces and I carry them with me. I always carry them with me. And one day when I'm ready, I will lay the pieces out. And it won't be like a puzzle where everything fits perfectly, because I feel so very far from perfect. But it will be a messy, vibrant, beautiful collage of all the adversity we have faced. And we will see that the overcoming is the art. And it's beautiful.
Okay, ladies, let's get this screen share going. Okay, screen share. Okay, there we go. All right, welcome to Sexual Assault Prevention 101. Thank you for giving up your lunch break for this workshop. The world is a scary place for a woman, but it doesn't have to be. Today, we will discuss how you are in control of your fate. Oh yes, great use of the raise hand feature. Go ahead and unmute.
Yeah, shouldn't we wait for the boys to join the meeting before we start?
Mm-hmm. No? Okay, let's begin. Mm-hmm. Tip one, do not put your earbuds in at night. Blasting P. Diddy is not gonna drown out the noise of those predators. You don't wanna distract yourself, girls. Tip two, if you see a man walking near you on the street, just cross the street. Rule of thumb, if you can hear him, he's too close. Cross the street. And ladies, if you're at a party, don't drink too much. Don't put yourself in a dangerous situation. But if you do make that choice, do not leave your drink unattended. If you choose to leave it, ask a nice boy to watch it for you. Something or someone. This. Some cuties in there. Now for some true self-defense tips. If an attacker comes at you from the front, remember to surf and turf. You all know I live here with Miss Jones, and we will demonstrate the surf and turf. They choke you, you surf and turf. Does anyone need to see that again? What? Yes, we have a question.
That doesn't look like it works. Like, what if they're a lot stronger than you and clapping isn't enough to get them?
You know what, we're actually running a little bit behind on time already, so we're gonna leave that question for the end. And if you need to see it again, just check the recording.
This meeting isn't being recorded.
The next self-defense tip is the hips and pray. This is when the attacker attacks you from on top. So if you're being attacked from on top, put your hands like this, and thrust your hips up as you pray to the heavens. Hips and pray.
What if he's like a lot heavier than you though?
Oh, great question. The most important tip. When all else fails, just poke the attacker in the eyes, run away and yell. Next up is a big topic. Trigger warning, sexual assault.
Haven't we been talking about that this whole time?
And don't trigger warnings usually go at the beginning?
We will be discussing consent. You need to make sure you give proper consent. People can easily misinterpret things, so don't put your man in a difficult position. Does anyone know what time it is? Anyone?
Example oregano?
Time, example time.
Oh.
Can I have two volunteers, maybe two people who haven't yet spoken yet? Just unmute yourself and read for partner A and B. I'll wait.
Okay.
Do you want to have sex? That is not an answer.
Do you want to get pizza instead?
No, I want to have sex with you.
I would rather talk about something else, like pirates.
Okay, I like pirates.
Can anyone tell me why this was a successful encounter?
Because it cuts off the conversation about sex with a diversion?
Exactly. Now let's talk about what happens if it happens. If you have sex, even consensually, you will get pregnant and die. And now, if the worst happens, call 911. But don't abuse it. Only call if it's actually assault. You'll know when it really happens.
I am 7, and my uptight, God-fearing grandmother and I are together in a museum, hand in hand, surrounded by Michelangelo-esque paintings of characters from the Bible and the God I'd only known as love. I remember her tall Norwegian frame towering above me, straight and stern-faced. Out of nowhere, not considering the possible effect on a girl age 7, she said, "Elizabeth, if you have sex before you're married, God can strike you down and kill you with a bolt of lightning." That was it. Suddenly, God was accompanied by fear. I look back at that moment in complete and utter shock. Had I even known what sex was then? I can't remember. The only thing that has remained in my memory to fear's enjoyment is this. Choosing to have premarital sex bears consequence. Watch out for the lightning bolts. I am 12. And for the first time, I didn't find sex to be absolutely puke-inducing and horrible. I would practice pleasure only once the sun... Fuck, it's the moon, sorry. Okay. So I have some, like, old line stuck in my head, too, because, okay. I can go?
Yeah.
Okay, do I have to say my name again?
No, you can pick up from...
Oh, cool, September. Sorry.
No, you're good.
I am 12. And for the first time, I didn't find sex to be absolutely puke-inducing and horrible. I would practice pleasure only once the moon praised my longing and I was free to be me. My body and I danced together in the moonlight. Intimately innocent, a love song in my bones. Fear stayed locked in the closet. I decided for my 13th birthday I needed something that would remind me of my pleasure practice. A pleasure partner to carry even in broad daylight. My own little secret panty. Didn't matter the brand or shape, size or fit, but I preferred it pink. So for my 13th birthday, I asked for a thong and a purity ring. Teen Beat told me Selena Gomez had one after all. The ring, not the G-string. Because I promised purity, I unwrapped them both, while fear breathed down my neck. I am 20, And I fell for a boy, for his tenderness and care. He brought me back to that love song. My intimate dance was something we could share. There was no more room for fear. So I pulled fear to the side for a stern talking to. You're messing with my life. I never even believed in this, yet I was convinced it was the only way. In that moment, I decided to listen to my body, to trust myself, to believe that I was good. And that night, I had sex, and I didn't die. Still, I waited for the lightning bolts, for my life to stop. I thought I'd fail all my classes or lose a loved one. I held my breath. I am 22. It's been 2 years stormless. No lightning bolt has even grazed my relationship, my family, my world. I've released my shame that was rooted in ignorance, in fear, in the patriarchy of the church. And I've decided to carry my own lightning bolts, strong and fierce. They help me speak up and speak out to my family, to the faith, to those who try to shrink me. I love my body, and I take care of her needs. She is a woman of her own, and we walk hand in hand.
I'm a lucky young woman. I grew up in a household that taught me the validity and the importance of my emotions. In high school, I prided myself on being a loud and empowered woman, and I always assumed that that part of me would flourish in college too. The reality is, as soon as I got here and started speaking my mind, I was immediately met with disdain. I've been pegged as mean-spirited, too loud, a try-hard, whatever the fuck that means.
Female anger is too loud and whiny. The pitch is too high and the truths are too hard.
To be honest, I don't get angry often. But that might be a lie. Because I want to scream when someone breathes too loud or says a lot of words that don't really mean anything. And when I'm breaking down, I want to yell and pound my fists on the ground and maybe break something.
When a woman gets angry, it's always because of their hormones. You know, that time of the month. She's PMSing, overreacting, dramatic bitch, angry woman stereotype. Why don't men get excuses like that when they get angry?
I'm angry that my role in society was decided centuries ago by someone who does not know my heart, my soul, or my joy. I'm angry that I cannot enjoy this life to its fullest potential. That I sit on top of millions of women's accomplishments and I'm still towered over by men. I'm angry that how I look is more important than who I am. And sadly, I'm mad that he chose her.
My anger comes out as vehement tears, which makes it worse, because then I feel even weaker and less in control of my emotions. I want to practice being angry, especially when it comes to political and social issues.
My friend Miriam's anger inspires me. Righteous anger. When she hears a story about a woman's experience with sexual assault, she is angry. When she studies the school-to-prison pipeline, she is angry. When she reads about immigrants locked in cages, she is angry. I just sit there and cry and want to talk about it. I guess I should be grateful I at least feel something.
My mom and my sister are allowed to be angry, but for some reason I'm not. And I think I've made that up because I couldn't tell you why it's true. Maybe it's because I'm the oldest child, or because problems are big enough when I don't add mine to the mix.
What are you like when you're angry? He asked on the second date, an inappropriate question, there wasn't a third. I've been told I'm one of those people who is so kind that they never want to see me angry. They're right. When I am angry, you are fire. bursting and then disintegrating, crumbling to ash with your own match. Not me. I burn for no one. When I am angry, I am ice, piercing and probing, stealing the breath from your lungs, seeping into the cracks of your argument and breaking you. I like my anger. They don't. And being the kind person that I am, I warned him. You don't want to know.
Oh, to be an unencumbered woman with rage.
What to call it?
What to call it?
When you know other people have had it much worse.
When you're the one that invited him over.
When you found out that it happened to you after it happened to you.
When maybe you said yes.
When maybe you didn't say no.
What to call it?
When it was someone you loved.
When you know they didn't want to hurt you.
Definitely didn't mean to hurt you.
When you want to give them the benefit of the doubt.
When you want to forget it ever happened.
When it's so small it's not even worth talking about.
What to call it?
When you don't want to think of yourself as a victim.
When you just weren't into it. It wasn't...
When you're not pretty enough for it to have been.
When they could get any girl.
When they were just caught up in the moment.
When it had to happen to you eventually.
What to call it?
What to call it?
What if I just don't call it anything?
A white woman's tears can be some of the most dangerous shit in the world. Like with the Scottsboro boys, Emmett Till. Those women looked for an easy out, knowing that their distress could call down a life sentence, and they kept on crying. Enslavers' rape of African women was turned on its head, and Birth of a Nation taught us that black men were the predators, white women the prey. So these stories persist, and we continue to tell them. It's hard sometimes because you'll say this to a woman and we'll doubt ourselves, our lives, how we were screwed over. We clutch our purses or cross the street late at night when a man gets close, especially a black man. But what part of that is trauma? And what part of that is racism? And white cis women, we like to co-opt shit, knowing we have it easier than black women, trans women, indigenous women, Asian women, the list goes on and on. We'll take their pain like it's ours, but we won't bother to look them in the eye. Who are you hearing now, and who is missing? Whose are the stories we don't tell? And when a white woman cries, we see her as the victim when we don't insist she's doing it for attention, and we will listen every time to her worries about the world. After all, she's right. But swiftly as she sobs, the spotlight turns to her, and instead of fixing the broken world she rails against, we soothe and forget. White women. We have power. Not just the I'm independent and self-actualizing kind of power, which is true and important, but the scary my tears can poison kind too.
Breathe in. Hold it. Breathe out. Hold it.
It's not fair. The catchphrase of my childhood, a vocabulary staple to anyone with siblings, especially younger, still shadows my mind when I think about my sister. It's not fair that she doesn't have to study but naturally excels based on her intelligence. It's not fair that she can eat whatever she wants but still has the figure of a model. It's not fair that her first phone wasn't a flip phone but a lime green iPhone 4 or something.
It's not fair that she gets a built-in mentor and I am left to flounder. It's not fair that mistakes are hers to learn from and mine to make. But the most unfair part of it all is this forced notion of fairness that has creeped its way into my relationship with my own sister. I love my sister. She is the only person who has seen all of my soul, who shares my smile, my sense of humor, my genes, though she has the better ones. I love being her mentor. I love teaching her my mistakes. I love her more than anyone, though I only tell her that when I'm drunk. But for things to be fair, they need to be comparable, and we are not. We are sisters, two halves of the same whole, but we are not the same, and we shouldn't be measured by the same rules. This is how women constantly get pitted against each other. Constantly competing, always comparing, never allowed to just be uniquely ourselves. The world convinces us that everything has to be fair, that it's not fair that she gets this and I don't. Like we all have the same characteristics and quirks that are so easily weighed by a male judge evaluating us based on how we measure up to the women around us. Sisters get the worst of it. Inseparable is only a good thing when you choose it. Not when your counterpart's only distinguishable quality is being a better version of you. I want to just be me, and I'm sure she does too. But that's not the world we live in. It's not fair. It never will be. And that's okay, because I love her anyways.
Selfless. To be more concerned with the needs and wishes of others than with one's own.
As a child, I learned a woman is supposed to be agreeable and easy. She loves everyone, her family, her children, her parents, her church, with total and utter conviction. Yet she has no time to spend loving herself. She never runs out of love, of energy, of charm, or politeness. Instead, she has all to give and none to take. She is an ever-flowing river of self-denial. She runs softly.
I've always admired women who save some for themselves, but I've never felt like I could be one of those women. I think I'm afraid that if I stop serving other people, the individual who's left won't be of any interest to anyone. If I'm not making other people happy, then what do I have to offer? People praise me for my generosity, but it doesn't always feel good anymore. Because it feels like they're saying, thanks for handing out parts of you.
I'm trying to be more selfish, feeling what I feel without apologies instead of holding back my pain to be more convenient, agreeable, not so overbearing, and not so damn predictable.
Is it selfish to want to be successful? To imagine a life of comfort? To not want to have to cook and clean for a household that I created? To not even want little me's running around because it is so easy to screw up your kid?
I try to think of the last time I was selfless, and all I can think of is all the times I didn't speak up. But being quiet doesn't help anybody. Being quiet is not being selfless. I have important things to say too. And I will not sacrifice who I am to make other people feel better about themselves.
Is there such a thing as a selfless act? We as humans are almost universally, I say almost because who knows, are trained to want to be well-liked. And doing things for others typically makes us more liked.
So do I sew makeup wipes and wear a menstrual cup and be a vegetarian because it's good for the planet and it's the right thing to do, or because it makes me feel like a good person and lets other people know that I'm a good person? Can it be both? Can you do a selfless act that also helps yourself?
Okay, I'm confused. Why can't we be selfless? Does that insinuate we can't be both selfless and selfish? Can we just get rid of the negative connotations with either and let women be whatever the hell they want?
The birds in the sky look like pepper, I said to my mom on a road trip. I said the same thing to my mother when I was your age.
In the eyes of history, women have been wild, demure, intelligent, shameful, striking, caring, resilient, beautiful, outspoken, quiet, strong, subservient, essential, selfless, and selfish. We've been told to blend in and stand out, and we've learned to do both remarkably well. We've been innovators, homemakers, civil rights leaders, mothers, politicians, teachers, rebels, factory workers, writers, business owners. The list goes on and on. We have been the clear gorilla glue holding this country together, while the men go off to fight their wars or simply stop doing their jobs in Washington. To do: clean the kitchen, do the laundry, party it up, embrace free love, have a wildly successful career, and look great while doing it. I can play the caregiving housewife to my friends by day, then dance my heart out like a flapper in a speakeasy at night, all while getting my degree so I can go out and change the world. I want to. I have to. They aren't lying when they say we contain multitudes.
When I was 13, I dyed my pubes purple, just to have something of my own. Step one, strip down. At least take off your pants. You call the shots and shed everyone's piercing eyes and watering mouths as you undress. Step two, mix the bleach. Every foul word a man has called your girlish body has latched itself into your skin, and now you're cleaning the slate, taking it all away. Wash out the bleach. Step three, Vaseline. It's to protect your skin from staining, but it's also what your mother used to soften your face, your elbows, knees, after a bad day. Step four, take gobs of purple, rich and dark, and color yourself the way you've always wanted. It'll look a bit like Elmer's glue, and you'll imagine your kindergarten self staring up at you, a girl, almost a woman, painting over pain. Rinse. Every day during lunch, when you go from the cafeteria to a metal stall in the bathroom, you'll look down and smile. 'Cause you dyed your pubes purple just to have something to yourself.
I'd like to say I'm over my internalized homophobia because I'm not so much into self-hatred anymore. But then I catch myself questioning if I should include girls when asked how many people I've been with. As if that question were even appropriate to begin with. But why wouldn't they count? Well, what is sex, penetration or pleasure? Because you have certainly experienced one more than the other. And at least the women you've been with are soft and warm and have the decency to still lay with you even after they've come.
And I want to tear at my skin when I think of ideas of body count or promiscuity, because I know they're only ideas. Balanced feebly on scaffolding of insecure masculinity. But I still feel my stomach drop when fingers go inside of me. Because somehow it makes me feel like I've given something up, when I was the one who wanted it so badly all along. It takes me back to some tasteless high school sermon, comparing bodies to commodities, preaching depreciating value. And I left so pissed off, and even more pissed off that I didn't understand why church made me feel so worthless at that moment. Like everything I had to offer was already gone. And who would want me now?
She realized, as she stared at her bruised legs in the tub, that she was in love with herself. With the complexity of her own mind, with the sheer fact that she was good and she was bad. And she could recognize every bit of it and still look inside herself and think that it was so damn beautiful. How narcissistic, a part of her whispered. No, the stronger part insisted. How powerful.
I am an imposter.
I am a virgin masquerading as a feminist.
I am not confident in my sexuality.
I don't even understand my sexuality.
I am not a liberated woman.
Not like those girls who wield their vibrators like swords.
Slicing their way towards equality.
I barely know how to use my vibrator.
Or should I call it a vibe?
That's what the empowered women say.
I've definitely never orgasmed.
Not like the empowered women. Crushing the patriarchy between their thighs. I want to be like these empowered women.
I want to slash the word virgin with my vibrator sword.
Though I am inexperienced at swordplay.
That word.
Invented by priests and weaponized by devils.
Does not define me.
What defines me is this.
I may feel like an imposter.
But I'm still a feminist.
I may be a virgin.
But I'm still confident.
I may not understand myself fully yet.
But I'm still a liberated woman.
An empowered woman.
A woman.
Hi, ladies!
I'm Stacy.
And I'm Barb.
And today,
we're so excited to show you
a recipe sure to make you
It's perfect for if you're feeling you need to spice up your days in quarantine.
Oh, I've definitely been craving some cream.
Stacy!
Spies!
So without further ado, here is our special coconut cream pie recipe that is sure to make you cream your...
Barb!
Pants! Your pants! Silly me.
All right, let's get started.
Okay, should we set the mood?
We should set the mood.
Okay.
Alexa, play Let's Get It On by Marvin Gaye.
Yes! It's time to get our baking on.
I'll drink to that.
Cheers!
Delicious. All right. So first, we're gonna start with our coconut.
Wait. We have to decide. Sometimes you can either buy your own pie crust or you can make it yourself. I personally like to make my own pie crust, but everybody needs a little help sometimes.
You know. And personal tip, the dessert is more delicious when the kids are at Steve's and you can enjoy it alone.
Or just at least wait until the kids are asleep.
Barb,
You gotta do what you gotta do.
All right, why don't we get into it?
Let's get into it.
So I have this coconut mixture right here.
Yes.
And we're gonna start by just spreading it out all over the pan. So I just take a spoon like so.
Yes, you wanna get those baking sheets nice and wet.
Nice and
with
wet.
With cream.
So here I am just spreading, ladies.
Yes.
Looks super yummy. And then I'm gonna add more soon. There's more in the fridge, don't you worry.
You know what, I think we need the recipe. Can we pull it up on your iPad? I think we're getting our own recipe, you guys.
Oh, goodness, ladies, my mask. You
gotta be COVID conscious, Stacy. You got whipped cream in your hand.
This always happens. Why does this always happen?
You're too cute.
I pull the recipe up on my iPad. I didn't know that was there. Oh, I hate those darn gadgets.
Stacy,
why? Oh my goodness. All right, so we have the cream. Now it's time to get some eggs and some sugar.
Yes, of course.
And we're gonna combine the two, I was saying.
Of course.
Yum, yum, yum. Look at that, organic cane sugar. We usually like to eat organic, you know, just because our bodies are changing a little. So just grab whatever sugar and eggs you have. And then we're gonna, you know, usually I like to set out a towel once I combine the two because I don't like to make a mess.
Wow!
Okay, but you gotta pull out your electric handheld mixer.
Yes.
And if your beaters are feeling a bit dry, then you're just gonna wanna smooth some butter on them to lubricate them right on up. And then you're just gonna insert them real slowly. I shouldn't. No,
you're right.
Facebook Live is public. What do you ladies think?
Oh!
Oh, well, Barry!
Oh, but we haven't finished! We're not done with the pie!
Oh, we're so close! Alright, we're gonna go grab my charger.
See you ladies soon!
We'll see you ladies soon. How do I end this?
I don't know!
Ah.
You say we could get him. Oh, yes, you did. I said, ooh, baby.
Timeline of contradictions from ages 8 to 18. You are a leader. Be a leader. But don't be so obvious about it that the boy on the field trip declares, you know they'll do whatever you tell them. But he makes it sound like it's a bad thing. You are smart. Be smart. But not too smart so that the boy in the classroom calls you a computer, as if you couldn't possibly be a human girl. You are pretty. Be pretty. Pretty, yes. Beautiful? Maybe. Sexy? Nope, definitely not sexy. That's just for the liberated women on TV and your best friend with the pink hair. Take up the space you're given. No more, less if you can. Lose the weight, then feel guilty about why. And all the time, try to figure out if you love your body this way because it's human and healthy, or because they finally released the pocket model of you you've always wanted. The Grace Mini, now small enough to be talked over by even the least assertive of males. And you worry when your pants become too big on you, because you've been talked over enough already. And who are you if you aren't the too strong, too weak, too smart, too dumb, just pretty, not sexy, slightly overweight woman you've gotten used to? That's right. You. Qualifiers be damned.
I will tell you I love you with store-bought box brownies and candy-filled care packages and little notes of noticing hardships in a baggy t-shirt and a heart full of love. But food hasn't always meant love. In high school, I used food as a weapon, intended against others, but mostly against myself. Stressed, confused, broken. See, I didn't get at the time that if they're already hurting you, they don't care if you're hurting yourself. But I wore their insults like a baggy t-shirt that used to fit just right before they wove heartbreak into the seams, leaving me to be swallowed by fabric and fear. I still have that baggy t-shirt, hidden with buried boxed brownies and discarded care packages from when I tried to love myself. Every now and then, when it's time to tell someone I love them, and I've assembled the food and written the notes, I put back on that baggy t-shirt, ready to take their pain and weave it into the loosening seams. And every time, it gets a little less baggy as my love-filled heart fills the t-shirt.
pride. Oh, mother dear, we're not the fortunate ones, and girls, they wanna have fun. Oh, oh, girls just wanna have fun. The phone rings in the middle of the night. My father yells, what you gonna do with your life? Oh, daddy dear, I know you're still number one, but girls, they wanna have fun. Oh, oh, girls just wanna have fun. That's all they really want, some fun. When the working day is done, oh, girls, they wanna have fun. Oh, oh, girls just wanna have fun. Some boys take a beautiful girl and hide her away from the rest of the world. I wanna be the one to walk in the sun. Oh, girls, they wanna have fun. Oh, girls just wanna have fun. That's all they really want, some fun. When the working day is done, just wanna have fun.
I want to stop defining myself by what I give to other people.
I want to eat without justifying myself.
I want to be held.
I want to know myself better.
I want to feel comfortable closing at work alone.
I want to feel sexy without being ashamed of it.
I want to be truly happy for another girl's accomplishment.
I want to be with someone who sees the world like I do.
I want to go to bed.
I want to be able to give myself permission to enjoy sex.
I want to be believed when I tell my story.
I want to strengthen my friendships with women.
I want to not be afraid of failure.
I want to not have my identities equipped to my personality.
I want to be able to sleep by myself.
I want to speak without softening my ideas.
I want to trust in my own voice.
I want to take care of myself without feeling selfish.
I want to be a true ally.
I want to love so much it scares me.
I want to live the fullest life I can live.
I hope to become. I am not her yet. But I am trying. I am trying. This woman sleeps through the summer, getting suntanned and freckled, rising only to kiss the hottest part of the day. She comes alive in autumn, wearing gusts of wind around her shoulders. They say her smile reminds you of falling leaves, the ones that seem to make up their mind, to jump from the trees, arms outspread, descending willingly. Willingly. When this woman has insecurities, she folds them into brown paper and drops them in the bottom of vases overflowing with flowers. She wills herself to take them as nutrients and to bloom. She reminds herself that while flowers are beautiful, they are also fragile. And there is nothing wrong with suddenly choosing to sprout branches and become a tree. She must remember that oaks take longer to grow than lilies. Some nights she is fierce, but she never lets her tongue burn long before she spits it out,
even those nights, she still wishes on stars, on eyelashes, on times on the clock, on traditions, on words, on love, on you. She is not the kind of woman who is left crying in the car. When this woman opens her mouth to sob, she breathes in passion and inspiration. She replaces shallow, broken breaths with all the good things she has known. She inhales until her heart is a parking lot after a heavy rain. It is damp, it is sparkling. She is at peace. Because she chooses this way of breathing, she can exhale forgiveness. She made up her mind long ago to only cry when she needs to fill her own bath. This woman is wet clay, molding herself into what she wants. She is in no hurry, for it changes every day. She realized long ago that no mold will suffice. This woman does not punish herself for allowing others' hands to smooth out her rough edges. To soften does not always mean to become weaker. She knows she can always return to the kiln. She is still finding her best shape. I have an image of the woman I hope to become. I am not her yet. But I am trying. My God, I am trying.
Just wanna have